गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, आई वेलकम द बीकॉम फिफ्थ सेमिस्टर स्टूडेंट्स फॉर द क्लास ऑफ मैनेजमेंट प्रोसेस यूनिट टू। एंड व्हाट वी आर नाउ डिस्कसिंग फॉर द लास्ट वन लेक्चर, दिस इज द सेकेंड लेक्चर विथ रेफरेंस टू द इनफॉर्मल ग्रुप्स एंड इनफॉर्मल ऑर्गेनाइजेशन। टुडे वी विल हैव ए क्लोजर लुक टुवर्ड्स the reasons of emergence of informal groups, the benefits of the informal groups. If time permits, we'll go to the limitations of the informal groups. First of all, let us go for the clear-cut understanding of the reasons for the emergence of informal groups. As already we have some conceptual knowledge about informal groups, that these are not formally created groups according to the organizational hierarchy. It is purely personal, one-to-one understanding, wholehearted commitment towards each other, and a unofficial way of grouping of the people, right? So this type of formation of groups is called informal groups. Also, we have studied that the employees of the organization or the workers of the organization, even though they are formally attached to a group as per their divisionality of functions and the authority and responsibility or accountability subject to provided by the organization from time to time, irrespective of that, they are also the members of either one informal group or more than one informal groups. Because of their personal thinking, personal ideologies, beliefs, values and all. Now coming to the question, what are the reasons for the emergence of informal group? The first reason, working together may come together, right? Working together in the sense, the people who are working in one department or in one organization, having personal relationship or having closer social relationships or having identity of one to one or one to many in the organization, as they are associated within the same organization or within the same department, they will come together and enter into an informal association or a group. There are so many factors which can influence. Maybe the likeliness, maybe the dearness, maybe the commonality of interest, or maybe the other factors which can inspire the person or motivate the person to have a combination with such similar attitude-oriented people within the same organization to formulate into an informal group. Next one is similar values, ideologies, beliefs, attitudes and interests. People who are having similar values either towards the work or for towards the organization, having similar ideologies, maybe personal ideologies or social ideologies or organizational ideologies. People having beliefs, because of their exposure, because of their basic human nature or the personality factors, having their own perceptions as a part of their personality, their attitudes, sometimes positive, sometimes negative, towards the organization, towards the group, towards the formal organization structure, and having sometimes common or consensus interests among and between themselves. That may pave towards the formation of an informal group and drags a person towards the joining of that particular informal. The next point is need satisfaction. As already explained in the last class, human wants are unlimited. their desires are there continuously. According to the motivational concepts, there is no end for the need and generation of satisfaction. That's why you cannot stop the need generation among the people, because humans are psychological beings. The needs, desires and wants are continuous. They cannot be disrupted or come to a halt. So when one need is satisfied, instantly another need starts grooming in and explodes out. So automatically, maybe sometimes there may be a dissatisfaction arising due to their membership within the formal organization or the formal group. That may drag them towards the informal groups in order to satisfy their personal needs or departmental needs or functional needs, whatever it may be, or social needs also sometimes. Now coming to the question, to escape the monotony and fatigue mode. Already you might have the knowledge of the words monotony and fatigue. Monotony is the situation or a psychological state of mind where the people are vexed with continuously doing the same work for years together or days together. The fatigue is the resistance to do the work. See, both the conditions, either having monotony or fatigue or both. Employees or the people prefer to escape that or to avoid that and to have some diversified way of work culture in their mind or having some scenario. To go for that, they will be going for selecting a particular informal group or desire to join a particular informal group. It's on the other hand, you can say there may be a relaxation which can be obtained through by avoiding the monotony and fatigue. The other factors like social factors, caste, creed, religion, social identity, social image, what not, they also make the person to plunge into an informal group because of their either commonality or the influence or having a emotional state of mind to have a consensus with the other person. Henceforth, the social factors, the religious factors, the language factors, for example, in a big multinational corporation, there may be so many persons who can have a same mother tongue. Even though they are outside India, in a other country, foreign country, they may have a similarity. That similarity is having a common mother tongue. Or they might have originated from a common country, from the home country to the host country. So due to that, they may informally have a club. They may informally have an association. They may informally have a group. So that also a factor to make the people to enter into social patterns. Right? Next one, the benefits of informal groups. There are so many benefits of informal groups. At the same time, there are so many demerits or limitations to the informal groups also. Due to that, the organization may have a backdrop. First of all, let us go for the benefits of informal groups. The first benefit is, it is blended with formal groups, as I already told you. In every organization, there are formal groups. Apart from that, side by side, there are also informal groups. An employee or a worker who is a member of a formal group is also a member of either one or more than one informal groups of the same organization. While you are studying at become second year, the business communication and management, you might have learned that in the organization there is formal communication, no doubt. Apart from that, on the similar lines, the informal communication also flows in, which is also sometimes we call it as grapevine communication. So without the existence of informal, it is not stated that, it cannot be even stated that there will be a success purely because of the formal communication. Henceforth, both formal and informal communications need to have their own emphasis to have the functioning of the organization in a similar manner. It's a blend of both formal groups with informal groups do have their own impetus on the organizational goals, achievements and success. Henceforth, informal groups are part and parcel of the formal groups, you can say that. They are blended with each other. You cannot separately, diversifiedly see a formal group and an informal group all together. It's a blend. There is a blending of both the formal and informal groups within the organization. It's a benefit. Where sometimes the formal groups may not be in a position to achieve the targets or the results or the expected outcome, there the power of informal groups will make the formal groups to achieve the desired result. So due to that, the informal groups are a part and parcel of the formal groups. Go hand together. Go hand in hand with the formal groups in the organization. Next, reduces the work burden on the part of the formal manager. Oh, yes. Who is a manager? A manager is a person who gets the things done for the organization by others. Who manages is a manager. Now coming to the question, as a part of the managerial duty, the decision making is must, and it is riskier also, it should be timely also, it should take into consideration the scarcity of resources also, it should be also confined to the skill sets of the people with whom the manager is expected to get the things done, as a part of his duty of managing the organization or the department. Henceforth, there is a huge burden on the part of the formal functional manager or the formal manager of the organization. Then what is the role of informal organization here, informal group here? The informal group reduces that burden. It is not all necessary that the formal manager himself or herself is only the way to create the organizational goals or achieve the goals and success of the organization. It is a supporter. The informal groups act as a supporter informally to reduce the burden and risk of the formal manager in managing their group or organization or the functional area. Next one is bringing satisfaction and stability to the organization. As I said, it is must and ought that the existence of formal organization with informal groups also. So with this, the informal groups, what makes that person who is a part of the formal group is also a part of the informal group, tunes the mind of the person who is a formal member of a formal group. While tuning it, those desired things like satisfaction is going to be achieved, which is not possible to achieve in formal manner. And due to the satisfaction of those needs, desires and wants of a person, it is expected that the employees will get much more higher satisfaction either formally or informally, but most of the cases occasions in the formal manner, informal manner. So the satisfaction and stability of the organization is enunciated through the able support of the informal groups rather than the formal groups. Next, acts as a communication channel. As I said, it is not all the way needs to have the formal communication and formal channels only to run the organizational communication aspect. So it is must to have the informal communication also. So it is a supporter. It supports the formal communication so that it has to be much more perfectly being received by the members of the organization. So, whatever it may be, whether it is formal or informal, the ultimate ideology behind the communication is to reach the required person in a timely manner, in an exact manner, and get the feedback or the response as per the dimensions required by the sender of the communication. Maybe the manager, maybe the organization. So the informal communication strongly supports not only the formal communication but also the formal organization to achieve the results in a rectified manner or the required manner. The last one, it supports for effective work culture. As I said, either you do formally or informally, ultimately what is essential? To have a better work culture, better work environment, and better enrichment of the work culture also from time to time, in order to create the desired job satisfaction as well as positive motivation among the employees of the organization, either formally or informally. Now coming to the question of the limitations of the informal groups. The first one is informal groups. As the name itself is informal, there is no authenticity. When there is no authenticity, their work, their support, their contribution is not at all counted anywhere. Henceforth, you see, it is not being seen on the arena as a part and parcel of the organizational work culture or work environment or the success of any. The second one, it runs with the informal communication, means grapevine communication. We have already studied that the informal communication is the best platform to spread the rumors, gossips, and so many other organizational communication system may sometimes be even disrupted. So due to that, it may be a limitation on the part of the organization. Third one, where the people are, even though they are a member of a formal group, they may also be a member of one or more than one informal groups. Due to that, what happens? The secrecy of one department or one functional area may not have been protected. Apart from that, there is a cross-functional influence of the employees. Sometimes that may enter into a role conflict among the people also, or among the functional heads of the departments also. So due to that, there may be a negative influence on the part of the organizational work culture also. Apart from that, informal groups may sometimes lead towards the disturbances in the organization and may lead towards the conflicting situations, and the organization may enter into the doldrums. Right? With this, I would like to conclude the second unit with the informal groups. And we have studied what not? What is an informal group? What are the factors contributing for informal groups creation? Informal group and informal organization. The reasons for the emergence of informal groups. The benefits of informal groups. As well as the limitations of the informal groups. In the next episode, we'll go for the start of the third unit of the management process. Thank you very much. If you have a doubt, you ask and go for the assignments. Thank you.